Amen. Good morning, everyone. What a beautiful morning it is. The Lord has created for us to come together and to worship Him. I'm going to read a scripture to you out of Psalm 136, and it's kind of a call and answer thing, so I'm going to ask you guys to help me on that. And the response is just simply, His love endures forever. Let's practice that together. Here we go.
His love endures forever.
All right, and there's just four scriptures. Will your call that back? Anyway, it starts, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the God of gods.
His love endures forever.
Give thanks to the Lord of lords.
His love endures forever.
To Him who alone does great wonders.
His love endures forever.
Indeed, His love does endure forever. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand as we begin this morning and sing together, O for a Thousand Tongues. All right, carol.
O for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise, the glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad, the honors of Thy name. Jesus, the name that calms my fears, that bids my sorrows cease. Tis music in the sinner's ears, tis life and health and peace. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high His royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, His army shall He lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, stand in His strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you, ye dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with
of your love.
What manner of love
Based on Psalm 23, which is a favorite scripture of a lot of us, I know.
Oh Lord, you're my shepherd, you make me lie in fields of green, you lead me by the still waters, you restore righteousness to me. Though I walk through the valley, I will fear no evil thing, for you are with me, and you comfort me. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow. Thank you. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow wherever I go. Surely goodness, love, and mercy will follow wherever I go.
My Savior is always here for me.
does. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
All right. Thank you, Jim. Thank you, choir. Let's go ahead and turn in our Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4, who we're going to be at this morning. Appreciate the opportunity to be able to speak to you this morning, as Pastor Terry is just away just having some vacation time, and what an awesome opportunity it always is to be able to share with you from the Word of God. So let's begin our service this morning with a word of prayer, and then we'll dive right into what God has for us this morning. God, thank you so much for this day that you've just allowed us to have. What a great opportunity it is, and just to be able to be together, God. I'm so thankful for this church family and the body that's here this morning. Whether they're here in person or joining us online, we're so thankful for just the time that we can have together. And God, I pray that during this time, we would just put aside the things that are on our hearts and our minds that might distract us from what you have for us. And I just pray that the words that are just said this morning would be from you and about you and for you. And I pray that you would just help us to have an understanding of the truths behind your word of what you would have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So this morning I want to talk to you guys about words. Yeah, words. Words are important, okay? Words are important. Words matter. We use those in our everyday life, right? Like that's how we communicate. We use words. I may have said good morning to you as you walked in. You said good morning to me. We've had conversations throughout the morning. Like words are used in every way, shape, or form that helps shape our life. And some words are meaningful, right? Some words are meaningful. They have an impact on our lives. Sometimes we say things that we shouldn't say, right? We use words that we shouldn't say that may be hurtful or whatever. And like we use words at times that we shouldn't, unfortunately. And I don't know about you, but words have just been on my heart and my mind lately, right? They just have been, and for good reason. I think on so many levels we've just forgotten how to use our words and just the power behind what we say and how it really can affect people and how it really matters. You know, throughout my life, I can think and recall of times of words that people have spoken into my life. And I was trying to think of words that hold really some true meaning to me this morning, and some words that really have just affected my life. And I wanted to share some of those with you this morning, just so you could get an idea of kind of where I'm coming from. And so my list of meaningful words that have been shared with me throughout my life and that really affect my life. The first one is, do you want coffee? Okay, no, not really. But seriously, I'm an avid coffee drinker. I love coffee, but those words haven't affected my life that much, but I do love coffee. But here are the words that have affected my life and help shape the way that I am. And I probably, honestly, to be honest with you, I was having conversations with people afterwards, and I actually forgot some that were really important to me. But this is the list that I came up with to share with you this morning. The words, I love you. The words, I do. The words, you're having a boy. The words, you're having a girl. Okay, this one's really important to me. God has a purpose. We may not understand that purpose, but we must trust Him. And I have to just tell you a little bit behind that. At a former church that I was at, a pastor friend of mine had to share those words with me because we'd had 3 student deaths in the community that we were in. And so we were shaking pretty hard. We had 3 student deaths like within a span of like 3.5 months. And so, like, those words really resonate with me when it comes to tragedy, when it comes to something that's hard in your life. God has a purpose. We may not understand it, but we have to trust Him, okay? And I'll share this one with you later, the story behind it. But you can lead, no matter what age you are. The words, thank you. The words, but God. And then lastly, for God so loved. And those are just some words that have impacted my life. And I want you to begin to think, and in the bulletin, in your outline, you'll see at the very end, I'm going to go ahead and let you jump ahead a little bit, but on the last thing on your bulletin, it tells you, and to list, like, to think about words that have affected your life, and I want you to have that, just be thinking about those words that have affected your life, and we'll talk about that as we get closer to the end, but you get the idea, right? You get the idea. Words affect and impact our life, but the question that we need to ask this morning is, what do we do with our words? What do we do with those words that we use? You know, I believe God's Word gives us so many instructions, okay, and ways that we can use our words and the way that we should use our words. So let's dive right in and let's look at what God's Word has to say about how we should and how we can use our words. So Ephesians chapter 4, is where we're going to be at a little bit this morning, beginning in verse 17. It says this, it says, "Therefore, I say this and testify in the Lord. You should no longer live as the Gentiles live, in the futility of their thoughts. They are darkened in their understanding, excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them and because of the hardness of their hearts, because they became callous and gave themselves over to the promiscuity for the practice of every kind of impurity with the desire for more and more." And verse 20 says this, "But that is not how you came to know Christ, assuming you heard about him and were taught by him as the truth is in Jesus, to take off your former way of life, the old self that is corrupted by deceitful desires, to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to put on that new self, the one created according to God's likeness in righteousness and purity of the truth." Verse 25, it says, "Therefore, putting away lying, speak the truth, each to his own neighbor, because we are members of one another." Verse 26, "Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger, and don't give the devil an opportunity. Let the thief no longer steal. Instead, he is to do honest work with his own hands, so that he has something to share with anyone in need. No foul language should come from your mouth, but only for what is good for building up someone in need, so that it gives grace to those who hear." Verse 30, "And don't grieve God's Holy Spirit. You were sealed by him for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and anger and wrath and shouting and slander be removed from you, along with all malice. And be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving one another, just as God also forgave you in Christ." And chapter 5, verse 1 says, "Therefore, be imitators of God as dearly loved children." And I'll go into verse 2, "and walk in love." Okay? And walk in love. And I love this passage of Scripture. And it gives us some really good just examples of how we can use our words and how we should use our words. So let's just dive right in to this. Number one in your outline, words can share the power of the gospel, right? Words can share the power of the gospel. And throughout the thread of the New Testament, sharing the amazing news of Jesus simply wasn't, like, for us, like, we think about when we share something, we post it on Instagram or on Facebook, or we put it on Twitter or whatever social media that you use, or we have it in the local news, local newspaper, whatever. But that's not what we're talking about here. The power of vocal communication was vital in the communication of the good news of the gospel, right? It was so vital. And the disciples and the early church followers, they used their words to communicate that Christ was risen, that life was in him, and the new way for believers was through him. And in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 20 and 21, we see Paul. And Paul is speaking about how you came to know Christ, right? How you came to know Christ. And he assumes that you heard about him and you were taught by him and you know that Christ is the truth. And we see that again in John chapter 14, verse 6, where Jesus says, He is the truth. He is the truth. And Paul is speaking about a new Christian's relationship, which begins with hearing Christ and being taught about Christ. And it wasn't like in verses in 18 and 19 where we see these non-believers that were excluding God from their lives, right? And they had these hardened hearts. But the truth that's found in Christ is proclaimed and shared with them and with you, right? Words can share the power of the gospel. And at some point in time in your life, you were shared the truth of the gospel. Hopefully, someone shared that with you. And I'm not trying to take away the role of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit plays a vital role in you hearing about the good news and the gospel of Jesus Christ. But the words that are said and told to you are so vital, okay? They're so important, and they played a role in you hearing about Jesus. And on a different note, I have to ask myself this first, and then I'll ask you as well, when was the last time you shared the words of hope and of truth and the good news of the gospel and what God is doing in your life, when was the last time that you used your words and you shared that with somebody? When was the last time that you did that? You know, I have to think about that myself, because it's so easy for, like, with what I do, it's so easy to get into that routine and that habit of every week doing that I lose track of the importance of, oh yeah, like, this is what's important. Sharing the truth of God's word and sharing the gospel with those that I come into contact with. I love on Sunday nights what our students are doing. And if you're unaware, like, we have our Awana ministry on Sunday nights, but we also have our student ministry on Sunday nights. And I love that our students, when I say students, I mean our middle school and our high school students, they're plugging in and they're serving alongside of our adult leaders in the Awana ministry. But prior to that, we have a study with them. We give them time to come in and get what they need, get their study, and have time to be able to just be poured into by our student ministry leaders. And we've been talking with them each week about sharing the gospel, about sharing their stories, how to dive into God's word, know the truth behind it. Why? Because the words that they say, they matter to the kids that they're coming in contact with. Those words matter. And the words of the gospel and the power of the gospel and the ever-changing message of the gospel, right, the ever-life-changing message of the gospel should always be on our hearts and our minds to share somehow. And so I had to ask you this question. Are you ready? Like Paul said, you have heard it, and hopefully you have been taught. And so are you ready to use your words to share the truths of the gospel? So words can share the power of the gospel. Let's keep going. Number two, words can encourage believers in their walk with Christ. Have you ever had one of those days where you just felt disconnected? You ever felt like lonely, whatever the case may be, even like in your relationship with Christ, you had those days where you just didn't feel that connection with Him. You just didn't feel like as you're reading the Word, like you didn't feel that connection, or as you're praying, you didn't feel that connection. What about when you've went through something hard? We all have experienced different kinds of heartache and hardships in our lives, whether it's the loss of a job or the loss of a loved one or whatever that may be. Like, we all have felt that. We've all been there in some way, shape, or form. But then I love usually what happens when we do have a hardship in our life. Then comes the body of Christ, and someone steps in, and someone is encouraging. And they go a step further, and they continue to encourage. And along the way, they encourage your relationship with Christ. How are you pouring into your relationship with Christ in the midst of your heartache, in the midst of your struggle, in the midst of your pain? Like, words of encouragement go a long way in our relationship with Christ. We can do so much and encourage one another in our walk with Christ. And that goes the same for any relationship. Words of encouragement matter, but especially as we're striving to grow in our relationship with Christ. It's important to come alongside someone and ask them, hey, how's your prayer life? Hey, what are you reading in God's Word? Hey, what is God doing in your life right now? To come alongside with someone and encourage them and build them up. And going back to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 25, Paul explains that the new life that's in Christ, when we have this new life in Christ, how we speak to each other, it truly matters. How we speak to one another, it's really important. And we must speak truth to one another. We must encourage one another. And community, this community that we have with each other, the church body, the family that we have, it really, really matters. And it's really important. And so we need this throughout the course of our lives, especially as we're walking and growing in our relationship with Christ. It's so vital. We need to be encouraged because of the spiritual battle that we face, right? John chapter 8, verse 44 reminds us that Satan is the father of lies. And so many times, he tells us time and time again things that are not true about us. He tells you what a failure you are. He tells you that you're not good enough. He tells you, and you can fill in the blank for your own life, but he tells you these lies. But it's that in that point in time where as we're walking along and we're walking in Christ, that just as Christ is encouraging us, our brothers and sisters in Christ are encouraging us as well. Because Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12 tells us that the battle is not with each other. We're facing a spiritual battle, and Satan wants to get us, and Satan wants to destroy us, and he's going to do everything he can. So it's important we have our walk with Christ, but we also have encouragement from each other as we grow in our relationship with Christ. And throughout numerous times throughout the thread of Scripture, Satan does. He tries to destroy. He causes disunity. He tries to destroy our walk with him. But as believers, we must encourage each other's relationship with Christ. So words can share about the power of the gospel, and words can encourage each of us as believers in our walk with Christ. Simple enough, right? Simple enough in our words. But let's go a little bit further. Number three, words can build up and they can add value. Words can build up and they can add value. And I love this. I love this thought about what words can do for our lives. You know, as I was preparing this message, I got to the point where I was beginning to think about what words have been said to me and how, like, I have been impacted directly by certain words that have built me up and added value to my life. And I shared this story earlier this morning, and I'm sure I've shared it before because it's just so impactful in my life. When I was in high school, one of my coaches approached me after a basketball game, and he told me, he said, "You can lead no matter what your age is." And I shared that statement with you earlier. Well, a little backstory behind that is I got through with a basketball game one time, and I was a sophomore in high school, and I told my coach since then the impact that these words had on my life. I got through with a basketball game, and there was a couple players from the opposing team, and they said, "Hey, you want to come pray with us after the game?" Whoa, oh yeah, well, okay, yeah, I can do that. There's a couple of the other seniors on my team that said they would do the same. And as we're getting done with the game, I noticed the guys are all going back to the locker room. I'm kind of like stuck, like, okay, didn't we say we were going to pray with these guys? I'm just going to go with them. I'm just going to go with them. And I didn't do what I said I would do, right? I just left the court. I'll never forget what my coach said to me after the game. He pulled me aside. We'd won the game. He pulled me aside. And he said, "Hey, I just want you to know that, like, no matter what, like, you think, like, because of your age, you can lead. You can be a leader." Because we had a very senior-led basketball team. But he said you would do something. You can do it, and you can lead. I don't care what age you are. And as believers, like, words matter, and those words matter to me. And as believers, we get a chance to speak into each other's lives, and we get a chance to build each other up and add value to each other's lives. Now, as hard as that may be, right, we should strive to do that, even in difficult situations, even in hard situations. And unfortunately, that's not always the easiest thing to do, right? We're always going to have different kinds of heartache, different kinds of hardships. But in every situation, we should look to add value to someone's life, even when we disagree with them. Even when we have that time where, like, I don't disagree, but I'm going to try to add value to your life and build you up in the midst of that conversation. Easier said than done, and I get that, but that's what we should strive to do. But I love what Paul says in verse 29 of our text, okay? He says, "Let no foul language come from your mouth, but only for what is good for building up someone that is needed, so that it gives grace to those who hear." Let no language come out of your mouth that's foul, but only for what's building someone up. And I had to think of some different examples. Okay, so I had to pick family of some different examples that I wanted to use. And so I have, you know, Rachel and my kids. And so I said, one thing that comes to my mind was, "Rachel, you know, your dinner was really good last night. I love it when you cook that dinner." Okay, and whatever it is, I love that she cooked that dinner. That's a way that I can be encouraging and add value and build her up. Okay, Riley, a lot of you guys know that Riley plays soccer, and I love, we can say to him that, "Riley, you work so hard at goalie, your hard work is paying off," right? You can say that, we can say it to him as parents. We can add value and build to his life. Now, when it comes to something that may be kind of hard, okay, I can look at Tinley and say, "Tinley," which Tinley is, you guys know Tinley, she's not even two yet. We don't need to yell when we don't get our way. We should ask nicely. Again, easier said than done, and I get that. But you get the point. You get the point. We need to add value and build each other up when we have conversation. Doesn't it just give you such hope and encouragement and joy when someone builds you up and adds value to your life? Husbands and wives, your words can build up your spouse. Parents, your words can add value and build up your kids. Parents, grandparents, your words can add value to your teachers, to your kids' teachers, your kids' coaches, and all those people who are pouring into your kids' life. And when you're out in the community, are you building up someone? Are you having conversations with people to build them up? I know that we all have differences right now. I know that every single one of us has differences about so many different things, and I'm not going to get into that. But even in the midst of our differences, are we striving to build people up and add value, even if it's not given in return? Are we striving to do that? And I love what Matthew chapter 3, verse 13 through 17 says. And we see this picture where the Father just gives us a great example of building up and adding value. We see Jesus being baptized, and then as soon as he comes back out of the water, the Spirit of God descends on him like a dove, and He comes up out of the water, and I love what the Father has to say next. He says, "This is my Son with whom I am well pleased." Your words are important, and your words can build up and add value to someone's life. Do not take that for granted. Do not take for granted the power of what you can say to someone. And I love this example that we see in Matthew of building someone up. So your words can share the power of the gospel. Your words can encourage those that are around you, your church body, your family, your friends. Your words can add value and build someone up. But unfortunately, we have to look at the other side of this. Unfortunately, words, number four, words can destroy and words can tear down, right? Just as words can build up and add value, they can also destroy and tear down. And as I was preparing for this message, I got to this point again where, like, I begin to think about words that have directly been said to me to destroy and tear down my life. And I try not to dwell on that too much because it makes you down and discouraged and like, oh, I feel awful. But you guys get that. What makes someone use their words to destroy and tear you down? What makes that happen? Well, of course, the easiest answer would be, of course, sin. Our sinful nature. But let's dig a little bit deeper. And if you remember in our text, Paul talks about taking off that former life, right? Removing the former life. The old self has been corrupted by deceitful desires, verse 23. In verse 29, we looked at removing that foul language from your mouth. And in verse 31, Paul tells us to remove all bitterness and anger and wrath and shouting and slander, that old way of life. Each of those ways, they destroy our lives. And they lead to an unhealthy lifestyle. As a believer, one that has this new life and you're making that transition from the old into the new life, that should be our desire, to remove the words that we use that tear down and destroy and replace those with words that are adding value and building up in somebody's life. Add value to people's lives. Use your words wisely. And now that we've taken some time to look at what words can do, let's take just a minute and look at words that believers in Christ should speak, okay? Different idea here. We've looked at what words can do. Let's look at the words that we should speak. So jump over, if you would, to John chapter 8, real quickly. John chapter 8. Very familiar passage of Scripture that I'm sure that you're all familiar with. But John chapter 8, and I love this passage of Scripture, and it says this, beginning in verse 2, rather. It says, "At dawn, Jesus went to the temple again, and all the people were coming to him. And he sat down, and he began to teach them. Then the scribes and the Pharisees, they brought a woman caught in adultery, making her stand in the center. Teacher, they said to him, this woman was caught in the act of committing adultery. In the law that Moses commanded us to stone such women. What do you say? They asked, to trap him in order that they may find evidence to accuse him. And Jesus, he stooped down and started writing on the ground with his finger. And when they persisted in questioning him, he stood up and said, the one without sin among you, you should be the first to throw the first stone at her. Verse 8, then he stooped up again and continued writing on the ground. Rather, he stooped down again and continued writing on the ground. And when they heard this, they left one by one, starting with the older men. And only he was left with the woman in the center. And when Jesus stood up, he said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" Verse 11 says, "No one, Lord," she answered. "Neither do I condemn you," Jesus said. "Go, and from now on, do not sin anymore." And verse 12 says, Jesus spoke to them again, "I am the light of the world. Anyone who follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." So what are the words that we should speak? We've talked about what words can do, but let's look at some words that we should speak. Well, number one, we should speak words of hope, right? We should speak words of hope. And when we teach our students in our student ministry, I often ask this question, as we're diving into what God's Word has to say, what hope do you have according to this passage, and what hope can you find according to this passage? You see, throughout the thread of Scripture, right, despite all that goes on, whether it's through the people's disobedience, through God's judgment, and everything else in between, there's always this glimmer of hope that shines through. Always this glimmer of hope. And I love movies. I kind of think of a movie that everybody would like to relate to. But I love the Star Wars movies. I love all the 9 movies that are out now. There's always this thread of hope that good will overcome evil, right? There's always that thread of hope. Maybe you're not a movie buff. Maybe you don't like movies. But maybe you're a sports fan. You always have that hope that your team will pull off the upset, or they'll come back, or the improbable, right? We can go on and talk about so many different examples here, but you get the point, all right? Hope, we all long for it. We should use our words to speak about hope. And Jesus did. Jesus did just that. Let's look back at our passage. And we know that this woman, she was caught in adultery. And in that day and time, the law said that she should be stoned. She should be killed. But what Jesus does is he begins to write in the sand. And I love what he says to the Pharisees in verse 7. And as these men are condemning her, he says this, "The one that is without sin among you, you be the first to throw the stone at her." And how does this speak words of hope? You see, these men weren't without sin either. They were sinners just as much as she was. And as they begin to leave, I can only imagine how these words of hope echoed to this woman, right? You see, Jesus recognizes our sin, but he doesn't just point out our sin among you and me. He knows our sin. He knows all of our sin, right? And these words, the one that was without sin, echoed that you aren't alone in your sinful nature. And despite what you feel or think, we are all sinful people, okay? But we can and should look for ways to share words of hope. And in this case, we see Jesus point out that you're not alone. You're not alone. And sometimes we have to be reminded of that. Sometimes we need to be reminded that we're not the only one when we feel isolated, when we feel alone, when we're thinking that we're the only one who commits this sin, whatever. But we're reminded in the midst of our sinful nature, like, there is hope. There is hope. There is encouragement. There is love found in Christ. And so we should speak words of hope. We should speak those words that are so powerful to each other because of what Christ has done. So we should speak words of hope. Number two, we should speak words of encouragement. Okay, words of hope, words of encouragement. Yes, you are a sinner. You are a sinner. I'm a sinner. You're a sinner. We're all sinners. You know, whatever the sin may be, you may have lied. You may be prideful. You may be jealous. Whatever, etc. You fill in the blank. But then Jesus, he offers words of hope, but he also offers words of encouragement. And I love what it says in verses 10 and 11. It says this. It says, "When Jesus stood up, he said to her, 'Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?'" And verse 11 says, "No, Lord," she answered. "Neither do I condemn you," Jesus said. "Go, and from now on, do not sin anymore." Okay, do not sin anymore. And what he says next, like here in this passage, like offers such words of encouragement. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. And I love, like, you ever think about when you were a kid? Like when you were a kid and you did something, you took something that wasn't yours, or you made a mistake that you shouldn't have made, or whatever, you fill in the blank. You guys all have those your own stories when it comes to that. But think about what happened. Hopefully you had a good result. Like hopefully your parents said or whoever said to you, hey, I realize that you did that. Just don't do it again. Okay? Don't make that mistake again. Learn from that mistake. And I love what Jesus has to say to her. He says, I don't condemn you. Just don't do it anymore. Go and sin no more. And so Jesus offers words of encouragement. So he offers words of hope, words of encouragement. And then lastly, the words that we should speak should be words of life. Okay? Words of life. And this is really simple, but it's really profound what Jesus says in verse 12. He says, I am the light of the world. Anyone who follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. What a clear understanding of life that you can receive through Jesus Christ. He gives us hope, he gives us encouragement, and he gives us life. And so the question that I have to ask to you is this, like, have you experienced the life that he has given you? Have you experienced that? And I had you in the bulletin there in your outline, it says, what words have impacted your life? What words have impacted your life? And I don't know what that looks like for you. We're all different. We all have different experiences, different backgrounds, different personalities. Like something that someone said to me may not resonate to you and vice versa, right? We all have that one thing that someone says. Earlier, someone told me a word that they found impactful in their life was the words, and I didn't write this down, but it's true, was like the words, I'm sorry. Like, of course, like those words are impactful, but I didn't think about that, but somebody else did. And so, like, what words you say are different than the words that I say. But I ask you that and have you evaluate those words that have impacted your life, and hopefully these are the most impactful words of your life. For God so loved you that he gave his son for you, that if you believe, you can have life. And I paraphrase that, okay? But John 3:16, those words should resonate in your life. The hope that you can have in Jesus should resonate in your life. The words from the Scripture should resonate in your life to be life-changing. And so this morning, my challenge and my question to you is this. Have those words been the words that have been the most impactful to your life? Has the Scripture and the truth behind God's Word impacted your life so much that you're choosing to follow Him? And as a result of that, you're speaking words of encouragement. You're speaking words of life. You're speaking words of hope, right? You're adding value to someone's life. You're sharing the power of the gospel, and you're encouraging one another. All of that is a result of having a relationship with Christ. And so this morning, my challenge to you is this, and my challenge to you is this, is to think about the words that have impacted your life. Have the words of God's Word impacted your life enough and so much that you have chosen to follow Him this morning? My challenge to you is this. Begin to think about those words and ask yourself, have I decided to follow Christ because of what the truth of His Word has to say? Let's pray.